How's it going, everybody? Happy Thursday to you. This is Clint with the Die Hard MMA podcast, sponsored by Pub Sports Radio, coming to you with the Total Takedown for UFC Vegas 34. And what a wonderful Thursday it is. I've got the PFL on right now. We've got Bellator action tomorrow, the ultimate undefeated post weigh-in show tomorrow. And then, of course, Saturday, we finish off with UFC Vegas 34. It's a degenerate's MMA delight right now. Bask in it, everybody. Enjoy it while we got it. Today, we are looking over UFC Vegas 34, and we are talking about totals. How long do we think each fight is going to last? We're not going to pick a side. We're just going to say over, under fight does or doesn't go the distance. And yes, I apparently need a haircut. And taking a look at our very first fight of the night, we've got Sasha Palatnikov taking on Ramiz Brahimaj. Welterweight fight between these two men. And what we've got is Sasha, who's a fighter that only loses by way of finish. If Sasha has been beaten so far, it's been by knockout or submission. And you've got Ramiz Brahimaj, who is a submission machine. Usually, I like to have both fighters contribute to an under if I'm going to take it. We have the offensive firepower of Ramiz Brahimaj, the potential question mark of Brahimaj's cardio as the fight gets late if he doesn't get an early finish. And then, of course, the suspect defense and durability of Sasha Palatnikov, both absolutely giving me anything that I would possibly need. The under 2.5 in this spot is minus 125, and I think that's a pretty sweet spot. Now, personally, I've already backed Ramiz Brahimaj. I'm on him. I'm pretty confident in him. I'm on him pretty good, and I think he's going to get that early submission. I think those two kind of correlate. I think if this thing finishes early, it's probably Ramiz getting it done. So, yeah, I definitely lean to the under here. Lightweight fight. Roosevelt Roberts taking on Ignacio Bahamundes. This one's a little bit trickier in my opinion. Both guys have a ton of firepower, all right? Ignacio Bahamundes is a slick striker. He's long, he hits hard, he's got high volume. Roosevelt Roberts, you can say some of those same things about him. Good, solid striking, decent power in his hands, and then a very nasty offensive submission game. If you leave your neck out there for Roberts, he absolutely will take it home with him. Plus, he's going to have an experience edge here in this spot. The total, once again, is set at 2.5, and we got plus money on the under. We got plus 130, plus 135 on the under 2.5. That's definitely the way that I would be looking in this fight, because if Roosevelt Roberts can't get the ground game going, I think this thing is going to be a brawl. That's kind of what Ignacio does, is he forces a technical stand-up war, and I'm not sure really if either guy is capable of taking that kind of a fight with the opponent. And if Roosevelt Roberts does get this thing to the ground, I think Ignacio is in major danger of having some kind of neck or arm snapped off. Next up, we got a light heavyweight fight. William Knight taking on Fabio Charrance. Another very interesting fight here. So William Knight, even though this guy has big-time knockout power, he finishes a lot of people with those hands, he has a tendency of going over. He carries that power late with him, and he likes to drag people to the floor. They tend to slow down, gas out. He can explode, reload, get a couple of deep breaths in him, and then go again. And he just kind of outworks and outpaces these other mid to low level light heavyweights to get a finish late in the fight. Fabio Charrance is a guy that we're not even sure is UFC caliber. He's going to have a size advantage here. He'll be the bigger man, but he usually misses weight. I'm going to be watching very closely tomorrow at the weigh-ins to see how he looks on the scales, because if he comes in looking bad, I'm going to be all in on William Knight getting that finish. But Charrance, he backs up, he gives away ground, and then he waits for his opponent to slow down from beating him up before he puts on any sort of offense. He's got a decent submission game, but it's all off of his back. He tries to catch people in guillotines and stuff like that. William Knight, he's gonna definitely go forward, definitely go for those takedowns, but he doesn't have much of a neck. So I don't know how Fabio Charrance's gonna get that submission on him. I will give Fabio credit. He does have a really hard check left hook when people are coming in, but William Knight's a guy that is not easy to knock out. So I don't think that that's gonna do the trick. Total here set at 1.5. And honestly, I kind of lean to that over 1.5. That's a pretty popular pick this week, so it's not one that I'm planning on actually betting. But at minus 150, I think that's the way that you've got to look. William Knight is not going to take Fabio down in the first round and just maul and destroy him while he's fresh. He's going to wait until Fabio gasses out. And Fabio will be able to keep himself in this fight until later on. And kind of the flip side of this thing, unless William Knight makes a huge, horrendous mistake and leaves his neck out there or something like that, I don't see where Fabio Charrance is going to be the one submitting him. I think these guys are going to lean on each other, push each other up against the fence, maybe get a takedown for a bit of a scramble, something like that. I'm kind of feeling William Knight in round two, in round three, after Fabio gasses out. Again, this is really dependent on how he looks on the scales tomorrow. But if anything, he can't look worse than he did the last time out. So I do think we get to the second round. I think the over 1.5 is probably the way to look at this one. Women's bantamweight fight coming up next. Bea Malecki taking on Josiane Nunes. And this, I don't even know what you're supposed to do with this fight. All right, Bea Malecki is an absolute giant. She's huge. And she's taking on Josiane Nunes, who is tiny and hasn't fought anybody. The total set at 2.5. The over is minus 155, the under is plus 135, and this is one of those spots where maybe we can kind of turn the bias of women's MMA on its head. Bea Malecki has big, powerful clinch knees, and even though Josiane Nunes is durable and tough and gritty, I don't know how many of those she can take. So if Bea gets in there and roughs her up with the knees, we've got a problem. Josiane Nunes is a fish out of water on the ground. Bea Malecki's going to have a big, big submission advantage and a wrestling advantage. And then what we saw in Bea's first fight in the UFC against Veronica Macedo was that when Veronica closed the distance and tried to bomb on her from boxing range in close, that's when she had the most success. Now, Bea's got a brick for her head, so it didn't do anything, but she did have some success in that range, and that's exactly what Josiane Nunes does, is she closes the range, she gets in tight, and she goes to work with her hands. So if either of these women are going to have any type of success in this fight, I do think it goes under. I think under 2.5 at plus 135 for a small amount would be the way to look. Again, not sure I'm going to actually end up betting this one because it's so volatile, but Nunes puts herself in the fire. Bea Malecki can take advantage of that. The hole in the ground game of Nunes is a giant gaping red flag where I think Bea Malecki can probably get some kind of a rear naked choke on her if she makes any kind of mistake at all. We've seen Bea literally step into the mount position when her opponent is off balance because of how tall and long she is. So I would absolutely see something like that taking place here. And of course, with the striking power on both sides, either one can probably finish the other. So yeah, under 2.5 would definitely be the look for me, but not confident at all, and probably not touching that fight with a 10-foot pole. Next up, we have got a bantamweight fight. Brian Kelleher, boom, my guy, taking on Domingo Pilarte. And Domingo Pilarte is a prospect that ended up kind of being a bit of a bust. Brian Kelleher is a guy that he finishes people. He's out there looking for the finish with every single thing that he does. Domingo Pilarte likes to use a kicking game, stay at range, attack the legs. Brian Kelleher is going to have to close the distance, go to work with the offensive wrestling, or explode and use those hands as soon as he gets in close. He absolutely has the power to knock a guy like Domingo Pilarte out. And the last time we saw Domingo is he getting flatlined in the very first round after he hurt his opponent. He kind of is going to force the action in this spot. Both guys definitely have the offensive firepower to get a finish, and I don't know that Domingo Pilarte has the gas to continue on. So if this fight goes deep, I think Brian Kelleher with the wrestling is going to find an opportunity for either ground and pound or a submission. I have a hard time seeing Domingo Pilarte hang in there for a decision, winning or losing it. I think he's going to need to push the pace, get Brian Kelleher out of there early if he's going to have a shot at winning it, or Brian is going to either explode on him early, grind him out late. I think this thing finishes, but the bookies are on to it. We got a total set at 2.5. Over is plus 145. Under is minus 165. I'm definitely going to look under in this spot. Again, probably not a bet that I'm actually going to make, but tempting. The line's a little bit steep. I'm not a huge fan of it, but I do think it goes under 2.5. If you can get the alternate total at 1.5, that's where we start looking more towards maybe the over. It's about minus 140. I don't know if this is going to be a one-round fight. Remember, these are bantamweights, so it's not going to be just a one-hitter quitter more than likely. These guys are probably going to have to grind on each other a little bit. That second round is kind of the sweet spot where I feel like this fight might actually end. The final fight on the preliminary card. I do that every damn time. Austin Lingo taking on Luis Saldana. Now, most of you know if you follow me already, I'm on the Luis Saldana fight, absolutely. Total here set at 2.5. The under 2.5 is plus 110, plus 105, somewhere in that ballpark. Over 2.5 is minus 135 and minus 150 in one spot, it looks like. The way these guys match up, I mean, Austin Lingo, if he's winning this fight, I think he's finishing. That's really all it comes down to. He marches forward, he's got heavy hands, he's got sharp boxing. He's going to look for the kill every single time out there. Luis Saldana, he is slick on the feet. He maybe had a little bit of a hard time with Jordan Griffin in the grappling realm last time out, but we don't really expect Austin Lingo to come out and try and force him into a grappling match. I think this is going to be a chess game. I think this is going to be very tactical, striking, Lingo's going to be coming forward. Saldana's going to play the matador. And Austin Lingo is incredibly durable. So really, the way I see this fight playing out is either Austin Lingo's going to win by knockout, or this thing's going to go to decision. Maybe Austin Lingo has a chance with the aggression forward pressure if he's landing some heavy shots and having success. But more often than not, I think Luis Saldana is going to win this thing via decision by kind of outclassing his opponent, staying at range, avoiding the big power shots. So with only one guy really being the one I see finishing the fight, I do think it's going over. I think it's going the distance. As long as Luis Saldana minds his P's and Q's and stays safe, avoids the big power of Austin Lingo, I think it's making it to the judges' scorecards. Whether or not either guy wins, we don't have to worry about that. Total set at 2.5, the over at minus 135, I think is a pretty sweet deal for this one. Main card time, kicking off in style. They're doing my boys dirty, though. These guys absolutely should be the co-main event, but I know why these guys are kicking off the main card. We're going to get the main card started with one hell of a fight. That's why they're doing this. Flyweight fight, Alexandre Pantoja taking on my dude, Brandon Royval. Now, Pantoja, we've talked about how well-rounded this guy is. He can do it all. He can strike. He's got heavy hands. He's got slick movement. He controls the distance, the pace of the fight. He can grapple. He's a BJJ black belt. He's a strong wrestler. He's very physical for the division. I mean, Alexandre Pantoja checks off every single box you would ever want at a fighter in this weight class. Brandon Royval is almost the exact opposite. He's tall. He's long. He's slim. He thrives in chaos, and he forces chaos. He's a BJJ black belt himself. He throws crazy spinning things. He can throw spinning elbows and shit like that in tight where nobody else is going to expect anything like that coming. Very unorthodox. Massive clash of styles here. And what that leads to, I think, is this fight really is going to be determined by who can control what. So Alexandre Pantoja can maybe catch Brandon Royval with something big, but Royval knows how to dig deep, survive, and get himself through bad situations. So even though Pantoja does have some finishing upside here, I don't know that he's actually going to be able to pull it off. I more think he wins the fight by way of control. Slows the pace down, uses that grappling, stifles the BJJ of Royval on the mat. I think that's really the best path to victory for Pantoja, and that's what we've seen him doing kind of lately in his fights. Brandon Royval, on the other hand, he's going to thrive in the chaos. He's going to mix things up. He's going to make Pantoja question where he's going to be, throw stuff from crazy angles that come out of nowhere, and that kind of leads itself to a finish. The only issue with that is Pantoja is incredibly durable. Both these guys are so hard to finish that I think this fight's going over. Even if Brandon Royval has the success that I do think he will have in those chaotic situations that he creates, I think Pantoja might be tough enough to hang in there and survive. I'm not going to play the total on this one. Absolutely not. Both these guys can finish this fight at any point, but their durability is absolutely scaring me off of playing this total because I would be looking over. I'd be looking over 2.5, banking on both these guys being tough, hanging in there, doing what they've got to do. A title shot is on the line for this one, so neither of them really wants to lose. I think this is going to be a war. So saying it's going to be a war and then betting the over, that just doesn't really sit well with me. I think you've got to look at the over if you're going to play it, but I totally get it with the amount of firepower on both sides here. If you want to bet that under at plus money, I get that. I absolutely understand, but I think it's hitting the judges. Next fight up, lightweight fight, Vinc from hell, Pichel, taking on Austin Hubbard. This one's easy, over 2.5. It's minus 265. These guys are grinders. These guys don't generally tend to finish anybody, and they're both durable as hell. Austin Hubbard is a guy you've been able to submit if you're high level and super slick with your jiu-jitsu. Vinc Pichel, very high level, but he's position over submission. He's not the guy that's going to jump on your back and look for a rear naked choke. He's going to make sure he is stable, in guard, in top position, slowly work his way over to side control. If you get caught, if he gets put back between your legs, he'll ride it out in guard with a little bit of ground and pound. Like, he's never going to do anything risky to finish a fight. He's just going to work his way. He's a grinder. So because of the way these guys fight, the way that both them grind, unless one of them makes a huge mistake, or one of them, Austin Hubbard more than likely, makes some kind of drastic improvement in the off time that we haven't seen coming, this thing is going to the judges' scorecard. So the over 2.5 is minus 265. Fight goes to decision is minus 240. And this is the kind of fight where if you're going to play the over 2.5, no one is going to get killed in this fight, I don't think, in the last 2 minutes and 30 seconds. I would save yourself a little bit of money. Take the fight goes all the way to the judges' decision because both these guys have excellent gas tanks. In fact, I look to back both these guys in the third round against opponents with weaker gas tanks because they will always be there, and that's a trait that both of them possess. So definitely over. Definitely think this one's hitting the cards. Next up, we got Trevin Jones taking on shortcomer Saidyokub. And this fight was just put together. We don't have a total on it. Because of that, I expect that the total probably is going to be a 2.5. Saidyokub is a solid grappler. He's a grinder. He goes to decision a lot. Trevin Jones, recently we've been seeing him finish people left and right. I would be looking at Trevin Jones inside the distance on this one just because, like everybody else, we've seen what this kid can do. He's really stepped it up lately. He's turned a corner, and he's been taking people out in ways that we didn't expect. He's got heavy hands, BJJ black belt, and taking on a short-notice opponent that's stepping up on just a couple days. We got to see what this kid looks like at the weigh-ins. I don't know anything about Said. I don't have a lot of tape study done on him at this stage, so a lot of this is just kind of coming top-level knowledge, and we don't even have a line to talk about, so I can't give you too much of a read here. But what I kind of envision happening here is Seed slowing down because of the late notice fill in, because he's coming in without a full training camp. Trevin Jones is a guy that's been training, trying to fill in short notice wherever he can. This kid wants a fight, so he's ready to go. I have no questions about his gas tank or anything like that. I have no issues with his durability. We've seen how tough he can be and how he fights, scraps his way back into fights when he needs to. And if Said is mostly looking to grapple, if he's mostly looking to wrestle on a short notice fill in, on a bad gas tank, potentially because of it, I can see Trevin Jones finishing this thing a little bit late. I wouldn't want under 1.5. I'd probably want under 2.5 if they gave it to me. Jones inside the distance. Jones' money line is -150, or just a pass altogether. I'm really going to be watching these two guys closely at tomorrow's weigh-ins. Heavyweights up next. Parker Porter taking on Chase Sherman. And this is one that I think is going to end very, very, very quickly. And they're giving me a 2.5, which is extremely exciting for me. Total set at 2.5, and I'm more than likely going to be adding this to my card. I think I'm taking the under 2.5 here, -135. Parker Porter is a guy that I love. Absolutely love this guy. Great underdog story. Love cheering for this kid. He is coming with a vengeance in this spot. He's talked about wanting to win a bonus, and he's got an opponent that's going to be more than willing to meet him in the center in Chase Sherman. Sherman is a guy that's first round or bust. He either gets you out of there, knocks you dead with that big, heavy, inflated, USADA-powered fist of his, or he slows down, gasses out, has no gas tank, and if you have any sort of aggression or level of effort, he gets finished later on in the fight. He moved to Syndicate MMA. I'm expecting another level jump from him because he's still a relatively raw, relatively young fighter. I think he can still make improvements. And the way Parker Porter fights, blitzing forward with his hands low and his chin wide open, that's an open invitation for Chase Sherman to clip this guy. Both dudes have been knocked out. Parker's got a better gas tank. Chase Sherman is KO or bust. Perfect, perfect blender for this fight to get finished. And a lot of people know that. Everyone kind of seems to be looking that way. It's one of those crazy things where fight goes to decision is no, -175, -220, but we can get the under 2.5 at -135. A little bit of a suspect spot there. I'm not sure why the giant discount, because this is another one of those fights where that last 2 minutes and 30 seconds, I don't care about. If we're getting the over 2.5, we're getting the judges' scorecards, because Chase Sherman is going to be dead in the third round already, or both these guys are going to be so tired nobody's getting finished. So I can absolutely see this under 2.5 hitting. I can see the under 1.5 hitting if you want to take a shot on that at +140. It's the same exact story. It's just a little bit shorter of a timeline. More than likely, I think Chase Sherman wins this thing by first round knockout. But if he doesn't get that, I absolutely can see Parker Porter overwhelming him in the second round and getting him out of there, because he's got way more urgency than someone like Andre Arlovsky did in Chase Sherman's last fight. Co-main event. Now we're talking lightweights. Lightweights, Clay Guida taking on Mark Madsen. And holy crap, I've been raving about it online. Mark Madsen moved to my favorite gym, Fight Ready. He looks in peak physical condition. He has never looked this good before. He is absolutely shredded and ready to go. And I know a lot of people out there are talking about him having a bad gas tank, and adding more muscle to that is just going to make it worse. Let's be clear, at Fight Ready, they don't simply add muscle, they have a full system that gets you in peak physical condition. He's not just going to be physically stronger, he's going to have a better gas tank after training there and going through their program. So I'm not concerned, and he looks phenomenal, in the absolute best shape of his life. Clay Guida, we all know this guy. He's a grinder. His gas tank really is his specialty. He's going to stay on whoever he is fighting the entire fight. Awkward striking, sitting more on his punches a little bit lately. Showed off some nice power in his last fight against Michael Johnson. He scrambles well. He's got good submission attacks. He also leaves his neck hanging out there and has been choked out quite a bit himself. So both these guys, I mean, Mark Madsen is made out of steel. This guy's not finished by anybody, and he took everything Austin Hubbard had to hit him with in the third round when he was completely gassed out in his last fight, and he ate it. He just took it and kept coming forward. So I don't know that Clay Guida can amount more offense than Austin Hubbard did in the third round in this particular spot. I know Clay Guida is probably a better scrambler, a better wrestler than Austin Hubbard was, at least at the point that he fought Mark Madsen. So he might pose more of a problem. But I also think that Mark Madsen's time at fight ready is going to improve his capabilities there. The one thing we really got to talk about is Mark Madsen's a wrestler. That's pretty much all he does. If you're going to beat Clay Guida, you're either going to out-grapple him and grind on him, or you're going to submit him. Those are the two paths. Mark Madsen has never been finished. We have yet to see it. Clay Guida's a guy that, like I said, he's been sitting more on his punches. He's got a decent submission game himself, but we haven't seen a whole lot of finishes from him, period. So I'm not expecting much of a finish in this spot unless one comes late, because Clay Guida doesn't slow down. Maybe Mark slows down a little bit. Clay Guida leaves his neck out there. Maybe Mark can snatch it in the second round or something like that. But if he doesn't, maybe Clay gets his back in the third when he's gassed out and tired and takes him out. But those are kind of Hail Mary spots. I really don't think those are things that we can count on. The durability really is what we should be focusing on. Both guys incredibly tough to take down and finish. So because of that, I'm thinking over. I think the fight goes to decision. Over 2.5 is minus 245. Fight goes to the decision is minus 215. And again, actually, I'm going to take that back. This is not one of those spots where the last 2 minutes and 30 seconds don't matter, because if Mark Madsen's gas tank rears its head the way that it did in the Austin Hubbard fight, you're going to be sweating balls for those last 2 minutes and 30 seconds when Clay Guida has his back and is hunting for a rear naked choke. So on this one, play it safe. Take the 2.5 if you're going to go that way instead of taking fight goes the distance. Main event time, Kelvin Gastelum taking on Jared Cannonier. We have a total set at 3.5 for this one. Jared Cannonier, we all know, is an absolute monster. Massive power, can knock anybody out dead, coming off of a tough loss against Robert Whittaker where he broke his arm and was generally outclassed on the feet because of it, but really gave a hell of a fight during it, even though that was the case. Kelvin Gastelum, smaller, faster, athletic, explosive, likes to use those hands, been mixing in that wrestling and grappling a whole lot lately. Another story of durability, in my opinion, for both these guys. We have seen both of these fighters take the kitchen sink and just keep coming. So because of that, I'm not expecting a finish in this fight at all, really. Jared Cannonier, even though he's got that vaunted, explosive, crazy power, has yet to knock out anybody that's a legitimate title contender at 185. I mean, he took out Anderson Silva, but that was ancient Anderson Silva that, of course, isn't going to be able to keep up with a guy like this. Kelvin Gastelum, I think, should be able to stay safe, and if he does take some shots, we've seen him dig deep and dig through those kinds of situations to keep himself in fights already anyway. And even if this fight goes to the ground, even if Kelvin Gastelum tries to work in that grappling, Jared Cannonier is a solid wrestler. He's a big, strong dude. I don't see Kelvin Gastelum getting some kind of a fluky submission on him or something like that. I think Kelvin Gastelum, it's going to be all he can ask to just keep Jared Cannonier on the floor. So I don't see a ton of offense coming in that spot. And Jared Cannonier, you got to be a heavyweight to knock this guy out. Long story short, I'm taking the over. We've got an over set at 3.5, minus 125 to the over, plus 105 to the under. It looks like it's at a pick'em price tag at some points. And then 4.5 rounds, a lot of people have that available. It's a pick'em price as well, minus 110 to the over, minus 120 to the under, or minus 115 on both sides. I'm looking overs. I'm looking fight goes the distance on this one myself. I know it's slightly favored to go not the distance. I think a late finish is maybe on the table if one of these guys slows down. But if anybody slows down, it's going to be Jared, and he's the guy I'm counting on not getting finished. So unless Kelvin hurts him and just doesn't let up with his hand speed and the referee like pulls him off or something like that, that's kind of the only finish I really see coming from Kelvin Gastelum's side, and that would come in the fourth or the fifth round in this kind of a spot. So if you can get the alternate total of 2.5 and lay the minus 160 to go over, I like that a lot. If you can get the 3.5, minus 125 to go over, I like that a lot. If you get the 4.5, over minus 110, okay. If you want to take the even money, fight goes the distance, okay. I kind of like all the overs in this spot. You know, we've talked about the unders before. I'm looking overs in this spot because I just think both these guys are so tough and gritty and durable. They're going to hang in this fight. That's the total takedown, everybody. Smash that like button for me. Make sure you give this thing a retweet if you found it on Twitter. Thank you very much. Subscribe here to Pub Sports Radio, and we will see you tomorrow for the undefeated post-weigh-in show. Let's roll!